Makes me human. There was none of that around me. So I had to search for my one type of knowledge. I'd never been in high school. I'd never done what normal people, whatever normal is, I'd never done what they'd done. So I started writing. That's the only thing that I could do. I started writing short stories, poems. And then I seen this competition by, I think it was Ian Banks, one of the guys. And I still remember this clearly. The competition was that he wrote half a story and budding writers had to write the other half of the story. So I thought I could do that. That'd be a chance for me to start looking at the way other writers work and maybe fit my voice into that. So I've done that. But then I continued to write. I wrote my first proper short story. And some of my friends were in prison at the time. And they kind of knew that I wanted to change. And they kind of knew that I wasn't like them either. Because I was always a wee guy writing. I was always a wee guy doing something different, just being creative. So I sent the two short stories down to my friends in Kilmarnock prison who were in segregation. And a prison officer wrote to me and some of my friends. And what they said is, my story was shite, but that Ian Banks one was kind of good. But they mixed the stories up. They thought my story was great, and they thought Ian Banks' story was shite. That was my first sense of achievement. There was nothing. There was nothing intended. That was the first thing in my life that I'd done for myself. That was the first act of empowerment. What that one short story done was gave me a completely different sense of identity. I didn't want to have to be a writer. I could just be one. And that was a shock. Nobody had ever told me that I could write, that I could make a living like that. It was always, you need to do this, you need to do that. You'll leave school, you'll go and get a trade, you'll go and work at the town, you'll go and work for somebody, more importantly. And I kind of, and still to this day, I walk around the street often thinking there's something wrong. There's something wrong. I can't even look at my finger on it. There's something wrong. So back then when I was writing, I wrote about sexual abuse because it happened to me. I hadn't really told that many people. Never really told that many people. But I wrote it in a fictional short story. And I started getting letters. Facebook, I wasn't even on at the time. But I started getting some letters from people who for the first time had told people they'd been abused. And I think at that moment, completely that moment, I started seeing the link between creativity and humanity. Without any art college, without any professor, without anybody who claimed to be creative telling me this is what it is, I seen it and I dealt with it. And then I started thinking to myself, could I do other stuff? Could I make a film? So I wrote that short story, I got involved with a place called Pop and Video, and I wrote another short story called In For Life, except from this time it wasn't a story, it was a screenplay. Some help in writing a screenplay. So went out for a full day and I was going to use some of my friends. A lot of us at the time were dealing heroin, taking heroin, because that's all we knew, really. But what had happened was none of my pals showed up because I asked them to act for me and they were just like, aye, aye, nobody showed up. So maybe me and my vanny, I just jumped in and go, fuck it, I'll act. So I acted, my ex-partner, she acted. My son, 3-year-old, 4-year-old, he acted. That short film that I done won an MTV award for Disarming Britain. Somebody put it in a competition, so I got flown down to London. I got to see what being a filmmaker in London was all about. I want some of this. I really want some of this, especially at MTV, because I felt, again, that whole scheme attitude that I got, especially Scotland and council schemes, I wanted something to represent me. I love rap music. Rap, I did poetry. So I wanted something that the art form that I'd done that represented the people where I come from. So I came back up the road thinking there was going to be people waiting for me at the station, there was going to be job offers and they might have gone. So I go over there, then there's going to be that. So what happened with that is because I had no formal education whatsoever, that one short film that I'd done gave me the relevant work experience to go and try and do an HND. So before I flung myself into doing an HND, I went and done this course called Preparation for Digital Media. And that gave me a chance to see different disciplines in digital media, such as editing, Photoshop, some camera work. So I've done that, and while I was on that, of course, I started bothering the H&D lecturer and the film lecturer, because I wanted to be a filmmaker. I really wanted to be a director, right, if I'm honest. So I went to Fergus Rob, and he basically says to me, look, I didn't think you're going to manage to do this course, but I'm going to give you a chance because there's something about you. And I'd completed the prep for media and design. I'd never been in fucking school. I'm going to be a place in college where people have got their teeth, where they're healthy, they think different. I've come to an area where health, well-being, diet, addiction, alcoholism, social engineering of the areas, chip shop, bookies, knife crime, I'd come from an area like that, and that's all I knew. And then suddenly I'm in this big massive learning resource center, seeing these people who never had the same problems as us. They weren't losing relatives, or they weren't losing friends by whatever means. So I started seeing that the way that we lived in Murphy's, which is not a ball here away from you, I started seeing the way that we live is just a different world. I wouldn't be in common with somebody from Compton and what I have from Morningside. And I know that through art. I completely know that I've got more in common with inner city arts in Baltimore than what I do in places in Edinburgh, not even in Morningside, because that's what we represent. So once I started seeing the differences, the massive, massive differences, I kind of made an unconscious decision that I wanted to be a writer director. Because when you're a director, the standard route is you work as a runner, you work your way up and blah, blah, blah. But I wanted to write, and I wanted to make stuff, and I wanted to do it now. Because it was a survival coping mechanism in the world that I'd come from, such as the HIV epidemic, such as the methadone epidemic, such as the knife crime, etc, etc. I wanted to do that now, because the people who I was associated with were dying. Loads were down. And yeah, you had to wait and you had to work your way up industry ladder and stuff. So I kept making short films. When I was at college, I made a graduation film called Tolerance. And I clearly remember one of the wee guys from Trinity who was on my course. And it was like being on set with a real director. And then that's when I realised all the skills that the streets have taught me, all the skills of communication, adapting, psychology basically, could be transferred to the film director. And I could deal with somebody from Trinity Morningside as much as what I could deal with somebody from Colton and Murphy's. That was great, because I didn't have to go and learn. I didn't have to go and sit at university. I didn't have to go and build up debts. I didn't have to conform to academia, because I struggle with academia. So once I'd started discovering that these talents that I had in life could be transferred, I started asking, what else could I do in my life? What other things could I do? At this point, I had a daughter coming, so it was two children. And I really wanted to start changing all around me. And I started seeing that working with young folk was kind of a calling in life. Because I may be the first person in my scheme that says to a wee guy, go and do this, and go and do that, and it's positive. I didn't want anything back for it. I wanted to just guide people to a better place and create stepping stones that certainly just weren't there for me, and still, I'm not there. And once I started looking at young folk, I started seeing how important creativity actually is. Now, I know I'm preaching to the choir in a room like this saying how important creativity is, but I started seeing stuff that I'd never seen before, such as an agency who will remain unnamed because there's probably something here, but an agency that received money for the government as part of a knife crime initiative. I was working at a post-production company in Leaf. I mean, I seen where the money was coming for government and how it was going to this agency and how it was supposed to be helping these people who are affected by knife crime. I realised there should add sometimes a lot that comes with advertisement in the media. Because this was money that was taken from drug dealers, to the probably same scheme that I come from, given to the government or taken from the government, made a decision in government, goes through all the layers of salaries and stuff like that, and ends up as a £15,000 grassroots project that probably started as a £100,000 idea. So once I started seeing that, I kind of countered it. So I went to the violence reduction unit, I went to the YMCA, and I says, how can you have people in Leith saying that this is a problem in North Edinburgh and they're going to make a difference? And the other guy for this agency, standing in your shopping centre, protected by two policemen. Now what they've done in my shopping centre is, they walked around and they said, carry a knife, it will be life. They put a rat, carry a knife, it will be life. But they've done this in stencil. And I said to the policeman, how the fuck, if I'd done that, I'd get done for vandalism. But a guy from the agency said, if you can come into the mass shopping centre, spray paint this, surrounded by the police, and go away, we do stop. How are people get paid to transfer this, to bring this knowledge in? So, I done the only thing that I could do, I made a film. With these wee guys, we received funding, I got shown to the Parliament, and the people in Parliament loved it. They said, oh, this is great, the youngsters are empowered, they're having a safe environment where they can reflect upon their attitudes. And I started seeing many of this. More and more. So I went into a film festival in Sheffield. I was still addicted to drugs. This whole time I'm addicted to drugs, by the way. I'm kind of chaotic in my behaviour, to say the least. So I went to the Sheffield Documentary Festival and I started seeing possibly that I could get my first feature, because that was my kind of holy grail, get my first feature. So I went to the Sheffield Film Festival and they showed the scheme. The horrible poverty porn thing, and they were saying it's going to get shown throughout Britain. And I put my hand up at the Q&A at the end, and I said to the commissioner, are you proud of this? Because they were all sitting on this panel, I was possibly the only person for the council seeing that. And I could see that the guy wasn't proud of it. I could see the look in his eye. But the reason I could read that look in his eye is because at a young age, I'd learned to identify body language so fast, because if I never, I'd probably have died. So when I looked at Ewan's eye, Ewan Angus, the next day in the day, caught him going to the train station and run after him. I said, I want a film commission, you've got to see my short films, you've got to see my work, please, please. And he gave me his card and says, contact me when you're back up in Glasgow. So I went back, I was at the film festival, and everybody in the film festival, Ewan says that to everybody, when you get back up the road, then we'll get back in touch with you. But I did. I go back up the road. She says, this is what films I'm making right now. Please give me an opportunity. So I went into the BBC and he said, what do you want to make a film about? What's this documentary you want to make? And I says to him, well, I was brought up in your house and there was an HIV epidemic and I want to make a film that shows what happened to my people. That's a good premise, Gary, but Trainspotting has been done. But you will get your future film commission if you made it all the way out before. Okay. I didn't, in hindsight, I didn't realise what I'd done by making that autobiography. So I says yes. So again, I seen the power of art and how important it is to me in my life, because I took on subjects such as physical abuse from my dad, sexual abuse, social exclusion, the care system, HIV, blah, 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 blah. So much issues that had happened to me through my life that I had no sense of perspective on why it happened or how it happened. And I suspect if I never had that in my life, I would have just wanted to block all these emotions out. But the fact that I had a camera, I could sit right next to my dad, speak to my dad, ask him why he'd hit me, and I never felt a thing because the camera was there. And it wasn't just because the camera was there, because I knew I wasn't speaking Gary to Gary Senior. I was speaking to son to dad, and that shown. And I've seen it at film festivals in people's eyes, from Norway to Germany and wherever else I took the film. I've seen it, it connected. So again, I've seen the power of art, creativity, filmmaking, stuff that nobody had ever taught me. Stuff that I'd only gathered for myself, for the street knowledge that I've got for Glasgow, Edinburgh, London, etc. So I made the film, And I won a BAFTA, etc. I got to go to different countries. I got to speak to people in Amsterdam who were like me. I got to speak to people in Norway who were like me, people in Germany who were like me. And it was a privilege. It was an absolute privilege. So when most filmmakers were going to these film festivals and sending film folk, I was going to these film festivals and straight away going to like Amsterdam's version of Dublin, only because that doesn't happen. Like folk would usually go to Amsterdam City Centre and do all that sort of tourist stuff, but I wanted to meet real folk. I wanted to meet folk who were in a struggle, black, white, blah, blah, blah. I really wanted that because as an artist, there's no point in me sitting with artists. As an artist, I need to be in life. So, made the film, got to tour, etc. And then I was hit with the realisation, fuck, I need to come off the drugs. It's been 20 years. My soul was kind of tired. My head was tired. I was hurting. I'd had 3 kids. A failed relationship. But I knew that I had love in my life. I knew that I had compassion. I knew that I didn't think I was really a bad guy or that. So I made the conscious decision to come off. So while I was coming off, and in the process of coming off, my old college where I was teaching out there and lecturing and guest lecturing, and remember, I have no been to school, and I'm teaching these new guys how to go to uni. It's like the blind leading the blind, I suspect. But teaching, one of the first things that I said when I went into college, and I sort of had that realisation like 10 years ago, I was coming here doing smack. I come back 10 years now to teach. The first thing that I say is that you can't teach creativity. The only way creativity exists is by sharing experience. You can guide people to what they need, and you can be like water. And that's kind of what creativity is, I suppose. You just have to carve and water will flow. And especially younger kids, they're inquisitive by nature. If you do something with a passion, children, more often than not, will learn from you. Not because you teach them, but because they need to learn, they want to learn. It's part of our psychology, it's part of human psychology. So being at uni, I've been at college, I started seeing that when I was speaking to these people with passion, and I've got a bit of knowledge. I've been making films for 10 years now, as well as being an addict. I was making films, obviously. So sharing that experience, it was great. But there was something else inside me that says, I'm teaching in a college in North Edinburgh, conforming to academia. But something never felt right, because I could look out a window and I could see the area that I come from. And it didn't make a difference that I was teaching in this class and what I was sharing my experience on. It was irrelevant to it. And that bugged me. How the fuck can I be in North Edinburgh, assembly knowledge for Edinburgh College, but everybody in that college is looking at a window going, how do we teach any folk procedure back to class? So I don't know if it's the loyalty to where I come from, or what it was, sense of duty almost. I just kept working with the young kids where I come from, because the barriers that they were up against were massive. The opportunities that were there for the folk in that class were massive. So the juxtaposition between the two of them was evident. Basically, I was in a class with folk who, if they wanted it, they could go and get it. Compared to when I was working at the chip shop or working with these guys, if they wanted it, they had so much more work to put in. So it felt better and easier for me to work with these big guys. I've worked with over 40 of them now. One of them, maybe 40. Went on the addiction. What? None of them have went on to the jail. Two of them have been stabbed. That sounds shite, but that's great. They're breaking their own cycles, not because I've taught them, but because they had a safe environment to reflect on their attitudes in the society that they live. None of them really have went on to the creative industries. Most of them have went on to normal jobs, normal paid jobs. Most of them have went on to that, and they know dealing drugs And all the rest of that bullshit is fake. But at a young age, they managed to grasp this. So they didn't have to go through the life that I went to realise what it takes to empower themselves. And that's kind of what I'm speaking about today. Empowerment. And this isn't a pitch from a social enterprise. I run Wido Media, and we just appointed a board of directors. The sense of achievement for me sitting there in my own office and leave knowing that I can do anything that I want, it doesn't stop at 7 days a week. Like, I didn't have a normal 9-to-5 schedule. I'm a freelance creative artist. That's going to have a long ride, that's what I say. Freelance creative artist, I deserve to stay in power. But what we are doing right now, I don't know anybody else is doing it. I honestly didn't. As a business, when you set yourself up, being able to make yourself completely different from everybody else around you and identifying a niche in the market and blah blah blah, all the stuff that you're in my book, we've done. But something else is more important to me. While I'm talking about this whole filmmaking journey, I've been to Birmingham, I've been to Manchester, I've been to London, and while I was doing that, I never done the normal let's go and see the city thing. I went to the inner cities. I went in and going to Handsworth and Birmingham, an area where young black men have more in common with young white guys for pulping than what they do in their own cities. But nobody makes any attempt that I see to break down barriers of race. Something that I see is a moral duty for an artist, for a creative person. So we are setting up strategic partnerships in London, Birmingham, and it's not about money. It's about surviving, because if guys like me, the guys in London, the guys in Birmingham, if we can't use art to survive, we're fucked. Because there's so much politics that's getting played these days, right wing, left wing, social media. And may I add, our social media game is strong. We've just done a campaign there and got 50,000 likes. Our social media game is so far ahead of anybody that I know. You know why that is? Because we know how to interact with people. I've seen so much marketing that come of how they work with social media and stuff like that. We get. Why do we get? Because we're a youth-orientated movement. And there's nobody that gets social media better than youths. Now once, and hopefully over the next year, once it starts developing, potentially that means that we're harnessing an audience. We're creating an audience, we're harnessing it, we're mining the data, so we know when we have output or content on it, we know where it goes and we know who it goes to. That eventually will get monetized, that's his business and his prime business. But soon, we're going to be in a position to be running arts projects, inner city arts is what I like to call them. When these inner city art projects come along, we didn't need to be guys with schemes running them. We need creative people. We need people in the creative industries willing to share experience, willing to run projects, because government and unions and academia don't want to do it. But people who have got that creative knowledge need to share it. And may I add, these days, there needs to be made a social conscience for people who are creative. We can't have the inequality that we have and no face up to, no make work that at least challenges it. Right wing media is so focused on dividing people right now, and it's so obvious that if you can't see it, you're blind. So for me, not just as an artist, but just as a human, I need to be able to find somebody that I can counteract. I'm not a violent person. I'm not politically minded to engage with politics, but I am socially conscious. And I think a way for me, my kids, and the people where I come from to move forward, we need like-minded individuals who not just help, but inspire, create, empower, because these people need empowerment. We've just had 40 years of generations dependent on welfare. That psychology is going to take another 15 years to break, and people are going to get this. You know, people are really going to get this. There's so much money out there. It's what I'm sort of realising now as an entrepreneur. There's so much money out there. It's massive. I thought everybody was skinny. I thought this was meant by recession. No, it's not. So, yes. I think moving forward, I did want to move to London. I want to stay up in Scotland and really build a social enterprise and a movement that hopefully one day I'll just take over and making the social enterprise a daily thing. The people that come on it will learn enough life skills, they can go on to something else. So, yes, creativity and art, I suspect, is something that's not for a privileged and not for a select few, but so many people these days try and make it like that. So, my one impassioned plea to everybody that's here is, when you remember this thing that I've done today, try and do something. Try and do something. Just one day, just try and do something for somebody for a Scottish Council scheme. Just one day, just once. And see if it makes a bit of difference in your life. And if not, fuck. Then what? Just try it once and it's a start. There you go.
Beautiful. I'll take some questions from the audience, but just while you're gathering your thoughts. Has this already started, this social enterprise?
Yeah.
So it's already in the stores, you've already got your first kind of...
Business cards in my back pocket,
So does anyone have any questions for Garry? Do you want to shout or shall I come to you?
Hi there, that was brilliant. Thank you. I work in Stills Photography Gallery and I do engagement work there. And we do get funding to reach young people in marginalised communities. But as a girl who grew up in Gistorfin in Edinburgh, I don't know how to go out and reach these young people that we want to work with. So, any advice on how you reach them?
There's a photographer that was in the days a couple of days ago called Yoshi. Yoshi's been a friend of mine for coming on 9 years, and he kind of, a guy from New York, kind of realised it quickly that you've got to actually spend some time in a community. And I think a lot of organisations are based in the city centre and know that they want to help in Craigmillar, Wester Hills, Nidgee. But they didn't know how to, and I think the only thing that works is to spend time with my family. Like, it's so not obvious, but stay away from official organisations that are set up, because there's a certain amount of politics and bullshit that comes with that, you know? And I think there's something to be said for just spending time with my family. Work experience in the Stills, how many folk for Pilgrim Burgess, Royston, Dryle have some sort of work experience there that day, just to know that people up the town want to try and help, want to try and make a difference, because I believe they do, but they just don't know how to.
Any other questions? I think what's really interesting is all about creativity as a sort of catalyst for communication, and I'm super happy to bring you and your story into a space like this, because you've got a room full of creative people, but it's about those bridges. And do you have any ideas of how creative agencies could help? But like you say, the problem is that the kind of big established names alienate as well. So what's the kind of solution to that?
Well, I think everybody in this room recognises the essence of creativity is collaboration. That's the only way that creativity exists. So I think that obviously the way you set up just now, like video content for the charity for sector. If anybody in here that's agreed to work with domestic abuse, to deal with violence, to deal with drugs, to deal with but all this first sector stuff that I personally see a first sector that exists that I have no lived and experience in this, because I work in the first sector, you know? And we've got our offices based in Leith and we've got some real good business incubation, but everybody in my office is creative. Like, they've got nothing in common with me in terms of my life that I've had. But we respect each other, and I think one of the ways of moving forward, come down to the office, have a cup of coffee, see what we're actually doing. I.e. the social media campaign that just happened there, 50,000 likes. How many marketing companies would bite your hand off for that? The engagement that we've got is massive, because it's done through social media. The filmmaking that we're doing, the just finished a documentary just now to get presented to the First Minister on the 1st of December. Another commission yesterday came for BBC, so it's not like there's no work done, but I can't deal with this myself, you know? That's the reason he appointed the board of directors to try and open that wee bit to put, I think we've got a funding strategy, 150 grand there. So being able to identify a proposal, 10 grand, to run with the Stills Gallery, for instance. You know, it's not just about me coming up with ideas, but possibly sometimes I think as an entrepreneur, it's about coming up with an idea, then asking people, like, how do I make this happen? So it's not like I really didn't sit up here with all the answers, but I would rather beg the questions and try and see what the answers are.
Great. So if people want to get in touch with you, do you...
Wido Media, yeah. Because one of the things I say is obviously as well that when I have an article printed in the evening news, it says Wido, something they put in very common, somebody walks around in the state with a sense of bravado. I thought that the wee guys had come on and escaped the bullshit that's sometimes what seems like the destiny for them. The fact that they can come on, go to college, and that's why it's called Wido Media. So basically, it's Wido.scot. Our Facebook page is there as well for Wido Media, which has not been that good recently for my Facebook page. So yeah, business card in my back pocket, come up, speak to me, and then get a business card, come to the office, get a chat, and see how we can take over the road.
Thanks very much. On that, another round of applause for Garry.